Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful. Still, this is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 21 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. So, as mediums go, podcasting isn't necessarily the best for breaking news or upcoming events with hard deadlines because by its very nature, podcasting, for those who may not know, stands for portable on-demand broadcast. And it's that on-demand portion that makes it kind of hard to time things because you may listen to this the day it comes out. You might listen next week or even next year. So it's not necessarily the best for events that have a hard deadline. But that doesn't mean we can't cover them. And so as this podcast is being released, March 2017 is leading up to Social Media Marketing World 2017 in San Diego. And to celebrate, I'm dubbing this Social Media Marketing Week on the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. And I'm going to release an episode a day leading up to when SMMW starts on March 22nd, which is a Wednesday. So for the remainder of this week and Monday and Tuesday of next week, I'm going to release an episode a day of a speaker who is speaking at Social Media Marketing World. And if you're listening to this before March 22nd, 2017, there is still time to get tickets. And you can purchase tickets at bit.ly/MD_SMMW17. Or if, like myself, you can't make it out to San Diego, but you want to watch online, you can also buy virtual tickets at bit.ly/MD_SMMW17. I know those links are kind of clumsy. Those links will be in the show notes. I will greatly appreciate it if you are going to buy some tickets if you use those links, because the affiliate commissions really help support the show. And so, this episode, we are going to be joined by Mr. Park Howell. Park is the founder of the Business of Story platform, a trusted brand story strategist, and sought-after speaker on story marketing. He's a professor of storytelling and the Executive Masters of Sustainability and Leadership at Arizona State University. He's helped international brands including Coca Cola, Beyer Pharmaceuticals, Cummins Diesel, American Express, and the United States Air Force craft and tell compelling stories that sell. Park is also the host of the Business of Story podcast, which I am a big fan of. I've learned so much from that podcast, and I heavily encourage you to listen to it if you don't already. So, without further ado, let's get into our interview with Social Media Marketing World speaker, Park Howell. Park, thanks so much for joining me.
Hey, Tammy, awesome being here. Thanks for having me.
It's quite a pleasure. I'm an avid fan of your podcast, Business of Story, and you have 30 years of experience in advertising. Is that correct?
Yeah, you just made me flinch when you said that, but yeah.
No need to flinch. Experience is a good thing. It's a very good thing. So nobody starts at the top with a wealth of experience and teaching classes and all that good stuff. So tell us that story. Take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug and become enchanted with marketing?
Well, you know, I think it goes back when I was a young kid. I was taking piano lessons and I was writing music. I wrote all kinds of songs and it was just great fun. And I really was intrigued by the concert business. I got in as a roadie and I was doing some producing at Washington State University, bringing in shows in the Performing Arts Committee. And I loved the business side of the arts, of bringing artists in and then promoting them, you know, being backstage, doing the whole show thing. It was just great, great fun. So I studied communications, thinking, you know, I would get into marketing one way, shape, or form, public relations and journalism. And while I was doing that, I also studied and got a degree in music composition and theory, knowing I would probably never make any money in the music world, but I was just so fascinated by it. I loved it. And so I got two degrees, came out, really followed my communications world first. Working in public relations as a writer. And like you said, man, you know, nobody starts at the top. I was that lowly cubicle writer, knocking out press releases, going to lunch with the media, and that just wasn't any fun. Luckily, one of the firms I worked with had a little small advertising division that was getting kind of overwhelmed, and so they needed some ads written. I was kind of slow on the press release writing side, jumped over into that. And I said, man, this ad writing way more fun than the press release writing. So I just transferred, pivoted into advertising, and the rest is sort of history from there. Worked for a number of people for about 10 years until I started my own agency called Park & Co. in 1995, and ran that for 20 years, and then pivoted away from the ad world, or I should say the ad agency world, having been there, done that, not having any fun in it anymore, and now focus solely on story marketing and brand story strategy, helping businesses get their brand story straight.
Awesome. I can see that playing out as a made-for-TV movie. I'm sure there's really good stories in there. So when was the honeymoon over? When did you become disenchanted? Not necessarily disillusioned, but like we were previously talking about in the pre-interview chat, you know, this whole world can sort of get over-glamorized, but then when you get in it, that shiny veneer comes off, and it's time to get down to brass tacks. So when did that happen for you?
Yeah, I got to tell you, you know, a fantastic question. I'm going to say it was probably roughly around 2008, 2009, in the heart of the recession. I, like everybody else, you know, fighting our way through the recession. And luckily, we had some good clients on board, so it didn't bite us that bad. But one night, I'll never forget this, Temi. My wife and I were at home, we're watching TV, and I had my recliner pulled back, and I'm sitting there having a beer, watching, I don't even remember what we're watching, but I remember having this pit in my stomach thinking, man, I just want to succeed, I want to do so much more, I want the glamour of advertising and being one of those big dogs in advertising. I mean, it was like in my gut saying, this is what you think you want, but it's not really what you want. I mean, I literally had this voice telling me that, you know, this voice is saying, dude, you have bought into the wrong story, but I just didn't recognize it at the moment. And then the worst commercial I ever saw in my life came on, followed by the second worst commercial I ever saw in my life, followed by the third. And I started realizing everything I was seeing on TV, 98% of it was garbage. Right. And I asked myself, why do I want to aspire to do this, to work? And it's not aspire to create garbage, but for the most part, clients don't really allow you to explore the interesting aspects of the brand in a very creative way. They don't typically have the budgets to do it well. And so what you see on TV and get bombarded by is literally garbage. And that's when it started turning for me. And yet I still fought it for another 5-6 years trying to do my thing. And in September of 2015, I went through the landmark form and came out of the other end of that, a leadership training course, and said, you know, I'm not doing this anymore. I'm not having any fun at it. I don't like it as I did before. But what I do love is helping brands, really business leaders, business communicators, help them understand what their brand story is so they can first live into and prosper from that story. And then secondly, come out with meaningful communications, be it online world, inbound marketing, TV, radio, whatever. But I believe if they had more faith and honored their own story more, that they would do a better job of communicating to the world out there. So that's what I focus on solely now, is helping brands do just that without the whole agency production back end part.
Awesome. And it is so funny that you mentioned Landmark, because my co-author went through the Landmark form and she swears by it. Oh, okay. I have yet to do it. I need to do it because I've been letting life get in the way. But yeah, I totally resonate with that. So you're a man of a certain age. And if you had a time machine, you could go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum. Yes, I am a Whovian. I watch Doctor Who. What are the top three things that you would tell your younger self to help prepare for your career?
All right. Great, wonderful question. I'd go back to the ninth grade. And I would tell myself, number one, really stay focused in high school, in college. There are so many wonderful teachers around you to take advantage of, because I think it's in high school, and certainly as you start your first couple years in college, that the spark of what you really want to do starts kicking in. So I wished I had paid more attention. I kind of just, you know, like so many kids, you know, just sort of flopped my way through high school, then into college. And I started getting really serious about my education about my second year in college. So I wished I'd grown up a little bit sooner than that. So number one. Number two, I would tell myself, don't live into anybody else's story but your own. So I'm one of seven kids, and my six siblings have taken, pretty straightforward trajectories in their lives. One's a physical therapist. Two of them are in the construction management business, heavy construction, following in my dad's footsteps, who was a civil engineer. I've got a couple of them, three of them, that are in the horse business. My sister is an Arabian horse trainer and is in Scottsdale, Arizona right now for the big national Scottsdale Arabian show with some of their horses. I've got another brother who's an equine vet, and I've got another brother who's a horseshoer. So they've got horses covered from really literally head to toe.
Awesome.
I was the guy that pursued this sort of wacky, weird art kind of commercial, journalism type thing. And I think a lot of folks are kind of like, what is he up to? How is he going to make any money at that? And let's see what happens. And it's been a really great career for me. I think that I would have embraced that sooner by not, necessarily living into someone else's stories and expectations and living into my own. So that's what I think you learn in age. But I would go back to my ninth grade self and say, dude, just, follow your bliss, as Joseph Campbell says, live into the story that you really want to live into. And if you got passion and energy for that and you show up every single day, then the universe conspires to make that story happen for you.
You and me both.
Yeah.
I am the archetypical late bloomer. Like we were saying, I didn't really get serious until I was 28. So a little late for me, but I can definitely identify with that.
But then again, that's just a story, Temi, you're telling yourself. And we get this from Landmark Forum, too. So it's not necessarily late. It's just your timing. And your timing, works for you. And that's totally cool. It's not right. It's not wrong. It simply works for you. And I think, it's worked very well for you, it sounds like.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. I do appreciate that. So now I'm going to ask you to look into the future. So a lot of the marketing that I follow is mobile, and they talk about connected devices and Internet of Things. And sort of the default example that everybody gives for connected devices is your smart refrigerator that knows when you're out of milk and automatically adds it to your shopping list, and then the Amazon drone or delivery service brings it to your door. And that they call a closed loop environment, because in that scenario, people don't actually have to go into the supermarket anymore. And so there's been concerns like, okay, are marketers going to have a job in that type of scenario? And me personally, I'm not too worried, because the milk has to get into the refrigerator in the first place, right? But in a closed loop environment where everything is automated, what do you see the role of marketing being?
Interesting. Technology, we are outthinking ourselves, I think, in a lot of respects, and our brains are so amazing. And by the way, it's the same darn brain that was running around the Serengeti way back when. I read some studies that said if you brought in that Serengeti hunter and had him or her growing up in the same day as we are today, that their brains would develop exactly the same way. They'd be just as knowledgeable and just as intellectually capable as we are today. So to me, that's fascinating. Now, over time, we have learned and learned and learned and learned. That's what puts us, ahead of the caveman. However, the rest of us hasn't changed very much. So therefore, we've got this technological world, and you really see it in the digital realm, that we have created this cacophony of communication, this always-on 24/7 network that we can run from our own kitchen tables. So we are all competing for each other's voices. In fact, I say that, ADHD is now a communicable disease, and you and I and everybody else are the viruses. So the only way, then, I think this is fascinating, that you combat that is using the ancient power of storytelling, that same power that got that guy off the Serengeti and helped us all evolve and survive as human beings. Story make us uniquely human. So as this closed loop system comes together, we have this technology, presumably, that's just going to connect us. We never have to go outside of our houses, because this stuff is just going to automatically show up and whatever. The one missing element, in a crucial element in that, is that we are social beings. So we can only handle that for so long without going completely mad. We need to be interacting with people. I need to be getting feedback from you and my other friends of what's working in your life, what's not, what do you recommend, what's great to see out there. And that's where I think that marketing will never, ever go away, because it's just simply another form of that campfire storytelling. We have to have it as social beings. And so marketing, if more than anything, we're just going to need to figure out how to bring in the blood and guts of human connection, one-on-one, mano-a-mano connection through the stories we tell and share, and couple that with the advancements in technology. I don't think technology will ever, ever erase that. If anything, as it becomes more closed loop, our need to reach out and connect with people will become even more important, and marketing is going to play an enormous role in that. And that's why I'm a big proponent of story marketing, not content marketing. To me, content marketing misses the point. It comes down to story marketing, and as this closed loop society gets tighter and tighter, story marketing will become more important than ever.
I love that, and I tend to agree, because especially when you're talking about marketing tech or MarTech, there's this tendency to say that something new is going to kill off something old, like newspapers are dead, or email's dead, or X is dead. And while newspapers certainly aren't in the best of shape, they're still around, and nothing really kills off anything old. Yes, social media is the big buzzword, but email is your bread and butter. Like, without an email, you're homeless in a digital environment. Mm-hmm. So I absolutely tend to agree about the storytelling, because Snapchat and Instagram stories, what makes them good is that they're storytelling apps, right? When you really get down to it, is that you tell stories in short bursts. So could not agree with you more. So you, Gary V. Brian Solis, or, you know, insert whichever thought leader, if you're at a different conference, Jay Bear, whoever, you're all chilling at the bar, having a beer after a conference, having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the professional digital marketing landscape, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
Well, I would go back to absolutely story marketing. You know, content marketing, of course, is what we're all about. We all talk about it. And I think that's good. That's that first step, that big evolution into how do we use digital as marketers to connect with people. And that's content marketing. Make sure your content is good. You know, make sure your content is littered with keywords and SEO, and give us listicles in your content so people can scan. And what it takes out the equation is truly connecting with people. So, you know, like scanning content and scanning listicles to me is like eating a popsicle. It's good for a while. It sort of melts in your hand. And when you're done, you got a stick to throw away. And I'll tell you, Tammy, you don't remember a damn thing in there.
That's right.
So, that's where I think this next evolution that has been happening, but people aren't catching up to it quickly enough, is story marketing. Is take that content marketing and everything we know about SEO, and that is super important. But for crying out loud, share a human experience in the business point you are trying to make within your copy. And it's so critical, because otherwise you just have glazed over audiences scanning through your stuff unless you deliver them a story. And a story has a few aspects to it. You know if you're telling a story or not if your story has a specific time that it happens. And the more specific, the better, right down to the day and the hour, if you can do it. It's a story if you have a setting. You know, be specific on the location of where this happens. It's a story if you have a central character in it that your listeners or your viewers or your readers can connect with and live through. Understand and appreciate the journey that they're on, because it connects with something similar that has happened in their life. It's a story if you then have action. You have to have something take place. You can't just rattle off a whole list of features and functions and call that a story. It's not a story. So you have to have action. And typically in that action, you got to have conflict and resolution. You have to have a problem that our protagonist, the hero in this journey, overcomes, that your audience can relate to. And then finally, you have to have a business point. That's why you make your point in doing this. So sitting around with Jay and Jason and those guys, you know, they're really smart minds. And actually, they're really quite good storytellers, too, in their own way. But, you know, you notice some of their best work, they're always relating it to an event, something that has happened in their life, something they saw happen in a client's life, or something that they heard about that they can corroborate, that they then suck you in, they bring you in, and you read through and listen to that story, and then they deliver their point. That is the power of story marketing. And I can give you an example of what I just saw earlier this week about a very top level thinker in SC Johnson saying, you know, we're all storytellers at here at SC Johnson, and yet she failed to tell a story within the first 45 minutes of her presentation. So it breaks my heart. I'm like, no, you're not a storyteller. You're just giving us fat features and functions. You got to get down to telling us a story.
I love it. Something you say on your podcast is that we're hardwired for stories, not facts, because an event can kill us, but the fact can't. So I love how you break that down. And I hope you guys are taking notes. So we're going to take a short break. And then when we get back, we're going to dive deeper with Mr. Park Howell. So stick with me. We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave and now she's a multimillionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left him bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. Insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it, hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttemi.com to book me, and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon. And we're back. So, Park, without getting political, you know, to the best of your ability, but by all means express yourself, what is your take on the whole fake news controversy / crackdown? Just the other day, as we're recording this in February, Apple CEO Tim Cook actually called for a campaign against fake news. And just to back up to define some terms, we're talking about individuals who sort of present themselves as legitimate news outlets, but what they put forth is wholesale fabricated. It has no factual basis in reality whatsoever. And people are getting tricked in a very manipulative way. So do you think that Facebook and you know, corporations like Apple should step in, or are you more hands off, like it's a platform only and they don't have any business trying to be the arbiters of truth?
Wow. I would say no. I think it is good that they step in. I think fake news is insidious. It's hard to identify. You know, we can all get tricked by it, and we all have been tricked by it. And I don't think it's incumbent upon those platforms and companies like Apple to do it. I think, though, it's a right thing. I like to see their power and strength come in and help us with this. It's not that I think that they're not like a Fox News versus a CNN. They're trying to tell you, I don't believe that you better be watching, you know, you better be voting on this side of the aisle or that side of the aisle. But I think it does undermine the entire concept of the internet news gathering and feeding if we are all having to wade through a bunch of fake news sites to find what's real out there. My biggest concern about all of this is how our president is using this to try to, call all news fake news. It's very scary to me because it just lets him and his cronies try to get into people's heads of what they believe is real news, which, by the way, is mostly fake news and alternative facts coming out of the very, very top. So when we have it emanating from the White House, I think we have to have the strength, or I welcome the strength of Facebook's of the world, of, you know, Apple, of Silicon Valley, of helping, you know, us understand and vet through this and knock fake news off. I mean, it's just, it's the tyrant of being able to have complete access and democracy to all news coming in. You know, you just got to filter through what's good and what's bad. And I think we have, as long as they don't take it too far, you know, and as long as they don't get to a point of trying to cram down our throats what they think the news ought to be. But I don't see that happening.
Right, right. And I tend to agree. It's definitely a pickle and a little bit of a slippery slope. But it's, like you said, it's incumbent upon us as consumers to be, you know, digitally savvy. And because, you know, back when they tell you this in third grade, always get two or three sources, right? Don't just, you know, take what somebody gives you, you know, get another source. So I'm interested to see how this plays out, especially professionally. So, as you hinted at, large corporations are just now starting to get with the whole storytelling and digital marketing as a whole. However, they haven't put as much muscle behind it as traditional advertising in a lot of ways. But to the extent that they have, that ad spend has disproportionately gone to Facebook and Google, right? And so there's been this theory posed on the Marketing Companion podcast by Tom Webster and Mark Schaefer that if this trend continues, we may enter a space where you kind of have the digital haves and the digital have-nots, because, you know, that, you know, Facebook and Google are taking collectively, they're taking like 80-90% of the pie. And so do you see a situation where we're kind of being, the other players are kind of squeezed out and you have this monster, monster conglomerate? Or do you think that the internet will still stay open and free?
I'm hoping it stays open and free. There is a fantastic book that came out around 2009, 2010 called The Master Switch, that written by Stephen Wu. I believe he's a Cornell University professor, and he follows the growth of the communications industries, starting from the telegraph into, you know, the telephone and radio and TV all the way up to the internet. And he poses this question, this very question, is how long does it stay free and accessible? So I think it will. I think that as soon as somebody really takes a land grab on all of it, which maybe they're trying to do right now, some other ways of doing it, some other platforms may well pop up out of the dark net, out of some other places. Now, I'm not an expert on this area, in this area, but my hope is that there are enough people out there that they will, you know, they will shun some of these large conglomerates as they get bigger. The interesting thing I'm seeing now, Temi, is I'm having a number of people in my life that are now just getting off Facebook. They said, I'm done with it. I go to Google and I go to some of these other places to get my news. I'm wasting so much time on Facebook. I'm not getting any value out of it that I'm actually moving away, turning it off. I think they'll turn it off for a time. They may come back, but I think they might also be looking for some other platforms that maybe aren't as ubiquitous that they can get some things down. So I think it's going to come down to what does the consumer ultimately want. My hope is it remains free and democratized. These things have a way of not, but then there's always something else that pops up that takes over And that's the beauty of this particular book. It's the little guy in his garage that becomes the disrupting factor against the large, you know, that we've seen it from against Ma Bell. We've seen it, you know, I mean, Zuckerberg, the little guy in his garage at Harvard, you know, you see it across the board. So as soon as they get too big for their britches, there's someone else out there ready to disrupt them. And I'm just hoping that that'll continue on.
The master switch. I got to pick that up. Just so that you know that the story behind that question, there's a book called The Circle. And they're actually adapting it to a movie. And I believe Emma Watson, who played Hermione in the Harry Potter franchise, she's going to be playing in it. And the whole premise behind The Circle, if you haven't read it, is basically if Google and Facebook had a baby, it would be The Circle. Hmm. And of course, it goes on to this dystopian future where The Circle more or less penetrates everybody's mind. And so if you haven't read it or got the ebook or the audiobook, definitely pick up The Circle, because it's just one of those thought-provoking things that, you know. But anyway, that's why I asked the question the way that I asked it. That book, The Circle, you should definitely check that out as well.
The singularity of the circle, huh?
Mm-hmm. So last question, and I'll let you get back to your day, and I do appreciate you taking the time, but I am going to take just a few seconds to set it up, because I want you to understand why I'm asking it the way that I'm asking it. And it's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast, because in my personal and professional opinion, there's a gap in the professional digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. And by that, I mean somebody who works in-house at a corporation or at an agency. I'm not referring to digital entrepreneurship, somebody like a Pat Flynn or a John Lee Dumas, even though you could absolutely make the case that they're pros because they operate at such a high level. That ain't who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs, people who get a W-2 at the end of the year. And so just sort of using my own journey as an analog, you sort of start off rolling the dice on Google, and there's no guarantees on that. Yes, there's some good information out there, but it takes a little skill to root out. I mean, you might land on Convince and Convert. You might end up in Amway. Like, who knows, right? And so after you're done sort of meandering the wilds of Google for a year or 10, you get serious and you can do what I did, which is go back to school and get a degree. The issue with that is that it's expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 for my bachelor's, and it's time consuming because even though my degree program was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete, and a lot can happen in the digital space in that time frame. But by far the most common way that people educate themselves and disseminate best-in-class practices is through conferences and seminars. The problem with that is that even though in aggregate it's a lot less expensive than a degree, you have to have the money up front. So a lot of your better conferences like a South by Southwest or Social Media Marketing World or something like that, you're looking at between $500 and $1,500 just to get through the door. That does not include your flight, your hotel, Uber, eating out. Just to have your face in that place, $500 to $1,500. And by the time you add all that stuff back in, you're looking at $3,000 to $5,000 on a single conference. And so that can become cost prohibitive for a lot of people. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to crowdsource a more established way of professionalizing oneself that does not include rolling the dice on Google, selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, or coming up with a few grand out of pocket to go to a conference. So now that I just said all that, allow me to get to the actual question, which is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skill, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke, Park. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer, Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
Wow, you have thought through this. This is great, Tammy. How would I build Well, I would certainly go online. I would identify, number one, what it is that I wanted to do. What was the personal passion that was driving my professional pursuit? And I would first start there. So I would get up out of bed hungry. I would go and have my first meal. I'd have a cup of coffee, and I would write down literally, what is it that drives me? And I just harken back to my childhood and say, what really pushed me? In my case, you know, it was first music and writing a lot of music, and then understanding how does music come together and work. And I think that's what has really led me to story in this day and age, is how does it come together and work for us? How can you intentionally do it? So that's as an example. Then I would say, all right, who are the three people out there that I believe are doing the best work in this area? So I would have to spend the next week probably just do researching. I'd be online, you know, and to your point, I would research, I would find out who are the thought leaders, who's writing about it, who's talking about it, podcast-wise, video-wise, whatever. And then I have found, as so many thought leaders are online, they are really accessible. And if they're truly thought leaders, it means they're comfortable in their own skin, and it means they're going to get back to you. If they don't get back to you, then question their thought leadership. And if they don't get back to you, they're not somebody you want in your circle. I've learned that. So I would find out who those three people are I really want to get with, and I'd reach out to them. And then I would say, can I get you on a phone call? I need to talk to you, or a Skype session, you know, for even better than a phone call, because it kind of puts you person, you know, mano a mano with them. At which point then I would have my questions keyed up and ready to go, saying, here are my goals for the remainder of this month, in 6 months, and this year is what I'm trying to achieve. And I would simply ask them, how would you go about achieving those? And then I think I would follow up with the final question of saying, what can I do for you? How can I be of service to you? Now, as a freshman in college without any money but a meal plan, the first thought is, well, what do I possibly have to offer this individual? But you'd be surprised of your own experience through life, even up to that point, of what you could do. And then I'd be ready to even offer up some ideas of how I might be of service. It could be maybe writing a podcast or writing a blog for their content on their website. It could be sharing their material in a much greater way than I had been in the past. I don't know. I would think about what would be unique and helpful to that individual. And my goal would simply be to strike up a mentoring relationship with those thought leaders so that, you know, I could reach out to them again as I progress along the way. And I could be sharing my successes, my milestones along the way as I'm living into my story. But I think it really starts first is getting very clear as to what your story is. What is your personal passions that are driving your professional pursuits, and then be very pragmatic and intentional about how you go after it.
There you have it, folks. I hope you are taking notes, because you just got a master's class. Park, this has been tremendous. Thank you so much. Please take a moment. Tell us about Business A Story. Where can we get a hold of you? Your social media profiles. Where can we get some more of you?
Well, thanks, Temi. It's really, really great being on your show here. Businessastory.com. That's the place where I hang out these days. It's my platform that I teach, coach, speak, and consult on. And you can go there. There are plenty of downloadable free materials and tools. I do my podcast once a week. It comes out every Sunday, Business of Story. I am, you know, we're into our second year, and, you know, talking about waking up and getting after it, I learned from Joe Polizzi of Content Marketing World, who was on the show, is that it takes 16 months to really start gaining traction. And I saw that in my own world with Business of Story podcast. And in February here, it looks like we're going to eclipse the 20,000 download mark. So we are building some traction. We're building our audience. It's great having you listen in. You've done such a wonderful job of sharing that with your world. I appreciate that, Temi. And then finally, I will be at Social Media Marketing World. If you're going out there, I did a workshop last year. We had over 600 in attendance for it, and it's on story marketing and how you can use this very proven story cycle system to be intentional about your brand storytelling, both online and off. So be out there with me. That will be Wednesday, March 20th, 1 p.m. We have a 90-minute session. So hopefully, you know, we'll pack in another 600 folks there, and I hope to see you there.
Sounds great. You have it there, folks. Park, thank you so much. This has been tremendous.
Thank you, Temi. Have a great day.
you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. Really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.